Good morning. Welcome to First Presbyterian Church, where we worship and serve the Lord Jesus Christ. Our goal, our mission, is to open the gospel to Carson City and beyond. And so it is wonderful to see all of your eyes this morning. It's wonderful to be all together. I want to say welcome to everybody who is watching via the live stream or in the Family Life Center. It really is good to be together. Today, obviously, is Palm Sunday, and so if you would like, there are several vases of palm fronds in the narthex that you are welcome to take one when you go out and use it as a vehicle to share the good news with somebody in the community. And so just want to tell you that. Today does begin Holy Week. And there are a lot of activities, so I'm just going to kind of bang through these. So you know you are not required to attend all. You are invited to participate in whatever you can. And so beginning tomorrow morning at 6 a.m., posted on our YouTube channel, each morning will be one of the passion narratives from the gospel. Tomorrow will be the Gospel of Matthew, Tuesday will be the Gospel of Mark, Wednesday Luke, and Thursday the Gospel of John. They become public at 6 a.m. You don't have to be awake at 6 a.m. to see it. You may, but you need not, okay? So they'll be available going forward. The first three, the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, are about 45 minutes long each. Gospel of John is a little bit longer, takes about an hour 10, I think it is. These were recorded last year at the beginning of the pandemic, at the beginning of the shutdown. And so we were using the equipment we had on hand. And so you may notice a little bit of production quality difference. I'm just sharing that with you. So those are each day. Thursday, April 1st, is Maundy Thursday. And Maundy Thursday, 7 p.m. here in the sanctuary, we will have a Maundy Thursday Tenebrae service. It is a quiet service. It is a profound service. It is a reflective service, and you're invited to be here. Communion will be served that night. It is the remembrance of the Lord instituting the Lord's Supper. Good Friday here in the sanctuary from 1 to 3. The doors are going to be open. You're invited to come and sit and reflect on Jesus' death on the cross. What does it mean, and why did it happen? And just to be present, there's no program per se, but the sanctuary is open for prayer and reflection, and so you are invited to be here for that. Again, 1 to 3 in the afternoon. Next Sunday, Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, 10 a.m., one service here. We will have seating for as many as we can safely. The Family Life Center will be open, and if we need to go into Fellowship Hall, we can do that as well. And so all who would like to come and be here are welcome to be here. After the service, weather permitting, and we will know this, we should have a handle on this, he says, confidently going where angels fear to tread. We should know by the Wednesday announcements what the weather might look like. And so we should be able to really give an assessment as to what it's going to look like out there for the fellowship time. We want to invite you to linger and just be together. Before the service started here, before we went to the live stream, I was listening to the buzz in the room here. And I just have to tell you, is music. It is music to hear God's people loving on one another and fellowshipping together. It is such an incredible blessing. And so we want to invite you, if you are able, to come linger after Easter service next week, and we will look forward to what that event is. If you are new here, if this is your first time here, in the pew rack in front of most of you should be a card. It's an information card. I want to just welcome you here and invite you to let us know so we can share with you what the mission and the ministries are and let you know of opportunities that you have. And so if you would fill that out and put it in the offering tray. Also, if you didn't hear, we are doing COVID comfort levels just to help everybody out. We have people at various stages of the vaccines, people at various stages of comfort level. Green means that you're fully ready for people to come and love on you. Yellow is a little bit, we need to be careful. Red is, I'm doing everything I can to be here. And so this is not a judgment thing. It is more how we can communicate with one another in a very safe and easy way, our comfort levels. And so my hope is that we are going to do this for about the next 6 or 7 weeks and then it's moot, that we don't ever have to do it again. And so, yeah, so we can be in prayer for that. All right, a couple other announcements. The Bob and Cecilia Stansbury will be available after the service. They were taking pictures before the service. If you have not had your picture taken for the directory yet, I encourage and invite you to do so today. We are going to get that posted here. We think this week, right? Yes? This week. Yeah. So, if you haven't gotten the brochure about how to create an account and look at that, those are out in Narthex and you can read about that. All right. The Wednesday after Easter, not this Wednesday, but the Wednesday after Easter, April 7th, we are resuming the Hebrews Pastor Bible study that went on hiatus last year when everything shut down. For those of you who are interested and were participating, I'm going to encourage and invite you to read it all the way through in one sitting. I have to tell you, I was really, really tempted to create a quiz for the first class to see how many of you have kept up. I won't do that, I promise. So, and it is a good time for anyone who would like to join. Wednesday at 6:30, we're working out the logistics, so I can't tell you exactly where we're going to be. We think we're going to be in the Family Life Center and on Zoom. It will be a hybrid. We will be doing both simultaneously. And so if you can't make that Wednesday 6:30, it will be posted the next day on our YouTube channel. And you can send for the link and all the materials, and we'll get those to you. Yay, praise God. Okay, so friends, we've gathered today. This is a day of celebration. This is a day the Lord's made. We're going to rejoice and be glad in it. Today, we celebrate the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And so I want you to take some time just right now, quiet your phones, quiet the room around you, and let's spend the next few minutes remembering who it is that we've gathered to praise and give glory, laud, and honor. So, Karen?
Our call to worship today is from Psalm 118, verses 19 to 25. Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous may enter. I will give thanks to you, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. Let us worship God. Please stand as you are able as we sing praises to our God. Please join together in our unison prayer of confession. We praise you, Lord. We have gathered this morning to lift our voices to you and to proclaim your glory. Even as we do, God, we are aware of the ways we hold back. We often say the words of praise while at the same time thinking about something else. We pray for your help only to ignore it when it does like we want it to. We make our praise conditional upon your pleasing us. We confess our sin to you, O God, and ask you to remove it from us. You and you alone have provided for our salvation by sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us. And now please take a moment for your own silent, personal confession to God. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. By grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not as a result of works that no one should boast. When we turn from our sin and trust in the mercy of God through Jesus Christ, we are assured of the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen.
crown him Lord of all. We do that, and we celebrate that, and we trust that. And because we trust that, we know that he is trustworthy. And so he has invited and commanded us to come before him, to lift up the cares, the concerns of our hearts, that we might share with him our own cares and joys, of one another, and of the community into which we've been sent. So let's join now in a time of prayer together. Almighty God, your word sustains the weary. You bind up the brokenhearted and bring good news to the poor. As you entered into the chaos of Jerusalem, we also trust you to come to us in whatever turmoil we are experiencing. And even as some of us shout your praises, others among us cannot even murmur a word of hope. But you see us all, lined up by the road, or isolated in our homes, incarcerated or incapacitated, worried about our loved ones and those who are ill, and exhausted from caring for the sick or laboring. We know, Almighty God, you are moved with compassion. You came to Jerusalem, getting ever closer to the cross, pouring yourself out in order to bring forgiveness, reconciliation, and salvation unto life. Seeing you humble, riding on a donkey, vulnerable and unwilling to turn away from suffering, it gives us confidence to come boldly to you to pour out our hearts, crying both, Hosanna and God help us. We don't know how to voice our deepest needs or fears or hopes or longings, yet you know them all before a word is on our tongues. We cast everything before you, Lord of all, trusting your promise of an easy yoke and a light burden. Lord, we do pray for the healing for the sick, relief for the suffering, justice for the oppressed, relief for the exhausted, hope for the downtrodden, and comfort for those who mourn. And as we wonder what's going to come next, as we struggle with uncertainty and anxiety, we look to you, the Blessed One who comes in the name of the Lord, for help, for assurance, and for peace that passes all understanding. We ask, Lord, that you would hear our words of thanks and praise as we seek to cling closer to you. We give you thanks for your selfless sacrifice. Lord, we give thanks for healthcare professionals, for all those who have labored diligently and tirelessly throughout this last year, for all those who have been first responders. We're grateful for all those, including our deployed military and their families, who willingly volunteer to give of themselves to protect and to serve. We do pray specifically for the men and women in the armed forces, and we pray for them here by first name. Lord, you know their situation. We ask your protection and hand and strength on Alex, Cole, Daniel, Mercedes, Eric, Jordan, Zach, Connor, Taylor, Josh, Philip, Nick, Casey, Ryan, Eric, Dakota, Cody, Chris, Michael, Sam, Derek, Emily, Amaris, Colton, Andrew, Evan, Keith, Ryan, Andrew, Jessica, and John. Bless each one, protect them, and bless their families, O God, in times of separation. And Lord, we look forward to the day when military is not needed, when conflict is only a memory, and that reconciliation and resolution have been effected. Lord, there are many in this congregation that need your healing touch and your comforting care. We lift up to you Rex Baggett, and Linda Poole, Doris Wheeler, Omega, and Dewey. We ask your continued hand of healing and strength on Todd Wheeler and give you thanks for the ways that you have touched his life. Lord, we pray that you would open the eyes of the church, your people gathered in your name, that we would see where and how you are leading us to bear witness to you and to bless the community into which you've sent us. Strengthen us for the days ahead so that we remain faithful to you, your will, and your call until that day when we see you face to face. And Lord, hear us now as together we pray as Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Grace?
Good morning, everyone, and it's a pleasure to be here this morning with you. Many years ago, there were shouts on Palm Sunday, and today we remember Jesus' triumphant ride into Jerusalem. There were shouts of Hosanna to David, the son of David. Blessed is he who came in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. But you know, not everyone was welcoming him there, because there were also those plotting to kill him. This week is Holy Week, Passion Week, the last week of our Savior's life. But he continued to teach in the sanctuary and telling his disciples what was going to happen to him later in the week. He would be betrayed, hung on the cross, all for our sins. So I encourage you, take this paper along with you that tells you all the things that are happening this week, and ponder and remember what Christ did for you. Well, I remember when I was growing up and at home, and I'm sure my father did it as long as he was alive. Every Sunday, shortly after he got home from church, he would take the palm leaf, and we were given one long palm, as opposed to the compound palms that we receive here today. But he would fashion it into a cross, and with that cross, he would put it at the door frame of our kitchen door. That happened to be the door that we used all the time. Anybody who came to visit always used that door. And it was a reminder of what Jesus did for us on Good Friday. And every time he left the house, or any of us left the house or returned, I'm sure we were knowing that Christ was walking with us. And I want to leave you with, a few words from St. Patrick. Now, 11 days ago, Franklin Graham posted this. And he said, I want to remind you, we celebrate St. Patrick's Day because of St. Patrick, who is the patron saint of Ireland, not the leprechauns and the green beer that it's become so famous for. But he was a man, St. Patrick was a man who preached Christ throughout Ireland. And his heart was focused on what is most important and what should matter to us today. And he said, Christ with me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, Christ in me, Christ beneath me, Christ above me, Christ on my left and Christ on my right, Christ when I sit down, Christ when I arise. Christ in the mouth of everyone who speaks of me, Christ in the eye of everyone that sees me, Christ in the ear of everyone who hears me. Would the ushers please wait upon us?
Almighty God, receive our praise, receive our worship, receive our gifts, tithes, and offerings. May it all be pleasing in your sight. We ask, O Lord, that you would receive it, you would bless it, you would use it to the proclamation of your good news, salvation in Jesus Christ. For it's in his name we pray. Amen. And please be seated.
The Old Testament reading today is Psalm 118, verses 15 to 29. There are glad songs of victory in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord. The Lord has punished me severely, but he did not give me over to death. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever.
Our New Testament text today comes from Matthew chapter 21, and we're going to read verses 1 through 11. I invite you to hear the word of the Lord. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed him were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for all you have done. We ask your blessing now that in this time, in this space, through this media, that your word would go forth with boldness and clarity, touching and convicting hearts. May the words of my mouth, the meditation of all of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, because you, O God, are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, today is Palm Sunday, and Palm Sunday is a different kind of Sunday. It is a special day in the church's year, to be sure. And we make a big deal with the palms and the singing, and you've heard Psalm 118 probably 5 times already this morning. We talk about the parade Jesus led into Jerusalem. But it is a different Sunday in terms of preaching. Most Sundays, the focus is trying to mete out practical application from the text. We try and figure out how we can apply the lesson to our everyday life. What's the point of the story that's going to help me Monday, Thursday, or any other day of the week? What's in it for me? Palm Sunday is not exactly like that. I mean, there is practical application for these verses, but it's not about what's in it for you and me, at least not primarily. The point of Palm Sunday is Jesus. The point of Palm Sunday is the validation of Jesus as the Messiah, the anointed prophet, priest, and king of Israel. Palm Sunday has little to do with what I feel or how I want to think about things. Palm Sunday is about celebrating what God chose, proclaiming what God did, and marveling how deeply God loves us. It's not that we're irrelevant to the story, but rather we're not the primary focus of this story. This is Jesus' day. This event was the fulfillment of promises God had made through the prophets hundreds of years before it took place. The point and the application of Palm Sunday are the same. Look and see what God has done. Look and see what God is doing. Look and see what God will do. Now, on the surface, this text is pretty easy to explain. I mean, Jesus rode triumphantly into Jerusalem, but there's so much more going on here than a simple parade. These 11 verses take us on quite a journey. It was more than just a spontaneous demonstration. There are four parts of these 11 verses. You have Jesus' instructions to the disciples. You have the explanation of Jesus' instructions, then you get the parade, and then you get the response. And as we go through these, let me encourage you to keep in mind the point and application. Look and see. So the scene opened with Jesus' instructions to the two disciples. Go into the village ahead of them, bring him a donkey and a colt. And he said, if anybody says anything to you, tell them the Lord needs them, and he will send them immediately. You ever wondered about this part of the story? Right? If you have, I'm with you. I mean, I am completely on board with the notion that Jesus performed miracles, that he healed, he restored, he calmed the winds and the seas, and all of those things. But I just gotta wonder about Jesus using divine power to accomplish the equivalent of calling an Uber. I mean, seriously, why did Matthew even bother to put in this part of the story? It's a little off. It's like a little odd. Besides, I try and put myself in the position of the owner. I can't really get my head around being okay with two strangers showing up and wanting to take my animals, the most valuable possessions many families had, simply because they said the Lord needs them. Now, if I'm honest with you, I struggle to not be annoyed when somebody else in the family takes leftovers that I intended for lunch. Right? Here, this is more like walking out and seeing two guys I don't know taking our family cars and hearing them say, the Lord needs them. Really? I don't think so. Would it spoil the miraculous, the wonderful notion of Palm Sunday if we understood that Jesus had worked out all of these details ahead of time? That this might have been a pre-arranged code or password with the owner of the animals? I hope it doesn't spoil it for you. Advanced planning is not contrary to God's will or character. Remember Isaiah 42, 8 and 9. I am the Lord, that's my name. I give my glory, I give to no other, nor my praise to idols. See, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. God plans ahead. Even so, as applied here, what does this episode show us and why is it important? Two quick things. First, it shows us that Jesus knew that his entry into Jerusalem would be dangerous and controversial. So he took measures to protect both those helping him and the plan itself. He used code and agents to keep everything secret until the right time to reveal all. Second, it shows us Jesus was in charge. Palm Sunday didn't just happen. Jesus intended for it and orchestrated it. He wanted these specific details and made arrangements for it to be so. We're going to talk about why Jesus wanted those details in a moment. But why dwell on this? We need to see that God accomplishes his will through real people like you and me. He doesn't simply wave his hand from heaven. God works in and through history. God is as sovereign over the smallest practical physical details as the big picture narrative. The reason Matthew included these details is because they pull back the curtain on God's activity in our midst. In other words, Palm Sunday is all about look and see what God was doing. Well, after Jesus instructed the disciples to retrieve the animals, Matthew breaks into the narrative for a moment to make sure his readers understand what Jesus was doing. That is, why Jesus was making these particular choices. And Matthew pointed readers to the prophetic language found in Zechariah chapter 9. Zechariah is an Old Testament prophet. For the Jews of Jesus' day, Zechariah represented the all-American kind of can-do prophet. He's a cheerleader. He delivered a message of hope and encouragement for the Jews who had returned to Israel from exile in Babylon. And his was a tough love message. He exhorted the Jews to stop procrastinating and moping around in defeatism. Israel and the covenant with God was not dead or dying. Their frustration that things weren't going better was not how God saw things. Zechariah urged the people to give themselves wholeheartedly to the task of rebuilding the community and the temple. And in support of that challenge, Zechariah also was given a word to instill hope for Jerusalem's future role in God's kingdom. Even though times were tough now, good things were coming. Persevere. Hope. To a people who thought all of Israel's glory was in the past, Zechariah encouraged them that God was promising greater days ahead. Until then, they were to act faithfully and to do what God requires of them. So now, fast forward to Jesus' time. Remember that the Israel of Jesus' time was in a subservient state to the Roman Empire. Israel was occupied and oppressed by a foreign power. One of the key signs of Zechariah's promise of the better days of the coming kingdom was the appearance of the conquering king of peace. It was the imagery of the Messiah, the chosen one, the individual who would lead Israel in a bigger, stronger way than Moses had. Matthew quoted Zechariah 9:9, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you, triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." So that's the imagery. But consider the larger context from which that verse is quoted. Going on to chapter 9, verse 10, "He will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall command peace to the nations. His dominion shall be from sea to sea and the river to the ends of the earth. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you double. For I have bent Judah as my bow, and I've made Ephraim its arrow. I will arouse your sons, O Zion, against your sons, O Greece, and wield you like a warrior's sword. Then the Lord will appear over them, and his arrow go forth like lightning. The Lord God will sound the trumpet and march forth in the whirlwinds of the south. The Lord of hosts will protect them, and they shall devour and tread down the slingers. They shall drink their blood like wine and be full like a bowl, drenched like the corners of the altar. On that day, the Lord their God will save them, for they are the flock of his people. For like the jewels of a crown, they shall shine on his land. For what goodness and beauty are his. Grain shall make the young men flourish, and new wine the young women." All of which is to say, God was going to raise up a king to throw off Israel's oppressors and restore Israel to the covenant glory. Jesus knew what he was doing by employing specific imagery as the fulfillment of Zechariah's promise. For our purpose, we need to see that what God promises, God does. What God says will happen, does happen. And taking this ride in this way during this time, Jesus was physically and visually declaring himself to be the promised Messiah that Zechariah described hundreds of years earlier. And with that claim would come the expectations of deliverance for Israel. Matthew was showing how the stage was set for God's plans of redeeming Israel and the whole world, but in a way that the people did not understand at the time. So as we sit here today, as you're here in the pews, what are the promises of God that we are waiting and expecting to be fulfilled? I mean, certainly the full revelation of the kingdom of heaven and the return of Christ have to be at the top of that list, but what else? What else happens after the kingdom is revealed and Christ comes again? I mean, though times may be tough now, there are good things coming. Persevere. Hope. To a people who thought that the gospel's glory days are in the past, be encouraged that God has promised greater days ahead. Until then, we are to act faithfully and do what God requires of us. Again, Palm Sunday is all about look at what God has done. Remember what God has promised to do and see God do it. Well, after giving the Zechariah context for the scene, Matthew returns to the narrative. The disciples went into the village. They found the animals as Jesus described. They brought the animals back to Jesus, sat him on them, and off the group went. And while all that was going on, the crowds were gathering to get into Jerusalem. It's a time of high hopes. Why was it a time of high hopes? Even before Jesus showed up, it's important to remember that Palm Sunday took place in the context of the celebration of Passover. Jews had come to Jerusalem from all over the country for Passover. Passover was one of the three major festivals annually in Jerusalem. Celebrations lasted a week and to us would look an awful lot like the Nevada Day Parade. Okay? Long lines for everything. Great anticipation and excitement. And as the people stood in lines, they would repeat the rituals from as long back as they could remember. What would they do? They would sing as a community. Pilgrims coming into Jerusalem sang songs, songs we now have as Psalms 113 through 118, the Hallelujah Psalms. They all knew these songs. They were their version of Christmas carols. Someone would sing the first line, then they'd all join in. There would be a call and a response. These psalms are songs remembering how God delivered them from their enemies. And Passover itself was a festival different than the others. The other two major festivals were based on celebration of agricultural themes, first fruits and harvest. Passover celebrated God's deliverance from the oppression of Egypt. How God showed that he was more powerful than the Pharaoh, more powerful than the gods of the most powerful nation on earth. So as a result, the theme of the festival each year put a political edge on the singing. Pilgrims were Jewish, but living under Roman occupation. And in so many ways, these were protest songs. And as you think about the crowds on Palm Sunday trying to get into Jerusalem, don't think of an orderly parade like Disney's Main Street, you know, where people wait behind the ropes for the parade to pass by. Instead, think of the videos that we saw during the Arab Spring a decade ago. The uprisings in Tunisia and Egypt, Libya, Yemen, Bahrain, Saudi Arabia, and Jordan. Large crowds surging this way and then that. Military watching to see if they needed to intervene. In Jerusalem, the crowds would be surging to and through the gates. And the songs they were singing were much more political than "It's a Small World." Right? The lyrics were a statement of defiance to Rome's claim of sovereignty over them. These songs and these pilgrims shared the hope and the confidence that Yahweh would be victorious. They were prayers reminding God of those promises. Those conditions raised the anxiety for Israel's leaders for the possibility of revolution and riots. Politically, the Jewish leaders recognized that Passover already tested the limits of Roman tolerance. And as long as the crowds just sang old patriotic songs, wouldn't be any problems. As long as the crowds followed the familiar script, Romans wouldn't intervene, but deviate from the ordinary. Add anything that looked like it could spark a revolution, nobody could predict how long the Romans would stay on the sidelines. So the crowd gets excited, spreading cloaks on the road before Jesus, a sign of respect for royalty. They began cutting palms to wave them and lay them before him, the symbol of Israel's identity as God's chosen people, the identity of the Son of God. The call went up for Psalm 118 that we've heard today, and the crowd started singing with a new fervor. Psalm 118, even though it's traditional, is the psalm announcing the coming of a king. It remembers God's goodness to the dynasty of David. It's the culminating of the psalms of procession, beginning outside the gates and culminating, wrapping up inside the temple. Hosanna, they cry out, meaning, O Lord, save us. Blessed is he who comes in the name of Yahweh. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Psalm 118 is a call and response among three parties: the crowd, the king, and the priesthood of Israel. Psalm records the thoughts of the king. Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter and give thanks to Yahweh. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. In the psalm, the people respond, the stone the builders rejected has become the capstone, and the Lord has done this. It's marvelous in our eyes. This is the day the Lord's made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Then the priests were supposed to say, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar. And though they missed their part, the crowd knew the psalm and still cried out, Hosanna in the highest. The promised Messiah had come to Jerusalem. God had showed up. As we close here today, how many people do you know who struggle wishing that God would suddenly appear, riding on a white horse like a hero from a movie? Look at Palm Sunday, friends. What more does God need to do for us to see and believe? Remember the point of Palm Sunday. Look, see what God is doing. Shouting of the crowd, messianic appearance of Jesus riding on a colt, the approaching Passover, the energy, it all added up to Matthew's report. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred. Nervous, anxious, upset. And they asked, who is this? Crowd's response was, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee. The point of Palm Sunday is Jesus. The point of Palm Sunday is the validation of Jesus as the Messiah, the anointed prophet, priest, king of Israel. And for us, the point and the application are the same. Look and see what God has done. Look and see what God is doing. Look and see what God will do. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. Amen. Lord God, we do praise you. We praise you and thank you for your faithfulness. We praise you for what you have done. We praise you for what we see you doing. And we praise you, Lord, for the promises of what you will yet do. Oh, Lord, open our eyes that we would see what you have done, what you are doing, and what you will do. And loose our tongues that we would tell all, Jesus Christ is Lord of lords and King of kings. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And friends, as able, let's stand and sing All Glory, Laud, and Honor. Just a reminder, palms in the vases out there, if you want to take them, show the world, show the community, open the gospel to Carson City and beyond. And remember who is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest, remain, and abide with you all, now and forevermore. Amen.